Day 3 sessions of the Hyderabad Literary Festival, 2K15 version. We have today with us Meena Kandaswamy, with whom you heard yesterday reading the poems, and Nadi Palshikar, a writer, and the moderator today is Geeta Ramaswamy. May I welcome the three of them onto the dais. I'll introduce Geeta Ramaswamy briefly to you. Geeta Ramaswamy did her master's from Usmania University and went on to bring on social change at the grassroots level. She works through the Vyavasaya Koli Sangam and has also founded the Hyderabad Book Trust that provides, publishes and sells serious social literature in Telugu. So she's been very, very socially active and at the moment more involved in publishing. I welcome Geeta ma'am to take over.
Good morning to you all. We have a very interesting panel here today. Two women novelists, and both of them young, so both of them bold, hopefully. We have Nadi Palshikar to my right from Pune. Her novel was just out about 3 months ago, Suta, published by Alchemy, reviewed very widely. She is a doctor by training, a medical doctor by training, has now shifted to gender and culture studies. She has a daughter who is doing her MA first year, and the mother is also doing MA first year in gender and culture studies. So she has a lot of experience with women from the poorest backgrounds. She tells me she works with domestic maids, she practices as a doctor, treating domestic maids. So we're going to hear very interesting things from Nadi. Closer? Right. And Meena Kandaswamy is of course a very well known figure in the literary circuit. Apart from being a poetess, her latest novel, The Gypsy Goddess, has been published again also last year. And Meena also read yesterday, she read poetry yesterday. So many of you would be familiar with her. So can we just get on with the session? I think we start off with they would read a few excerpts from their works, and then we get on to a little more serious discussion. So can we start with Nadi first, please?
Just speak a few words. Thanks. I'm having a very good time here. So thanks, HLF. And thanks to my publisher, Mr. Mehra, who's here somewhere. Yes. Okay. Of Alchemy. Okay. So today's topic, the caste and gender. And I'm sure ma'am will take us through, looking at how caste is represented in the English Indian fiction today. Okay. Usually we see caste when the stories are set in the village, as if it's not a reality in the contemporary urban, we always say that, oh, there is Dalit literature, and we have this very nice attitude that it's there and I read it sometimes, okay, but it's not in my writing. That is also there and this is there. We say that as if it is not relational, as if we don't stop to ask why is Dalit literature coming up only now? Why hasn't it come up in history? It is because the mainstream was powerful and oppressive that the Dalit literature did not come up. But we seem to take a very nice attitude that, I'm sensitive and I have a sensitive response to that, and then label it as authentic victimhood and all that. But in my stories, why should it come in my story? My story is a simple love story. Why put caste in it? It is this kind of marginalization of the oppressed experience, okay, which is leading to further non-understanding of two things. One is that caste is not something which is a retrograde past that I just feel ashamed and guilty about it. It is reproduced. It's reproduced continuously in the social inequalities of today. Okay? Because the structural inequality is reproduced in social reality. So that is continuous. We go on feeling it's a past and we don't deal with it. So it stays. Okay? And so what do we do about it? It's not just that we add some Dalit issues to it and stir. Some Dalit issues, some Dalit problems and stir. Because that won't be giving agency to the Dalit woman. Then it is not a true change. Okay. So here in my book, it is about two rich girls. They are from the upper class, upper caste and everything. But there is this friend called Nakusa. So I'm going to read about her. Okay. Ma'am, you can stop me anytime if I'm time. Now this part, the language is that of a small child. Okay, because she's talking about a time when, it's not in the first person, but our protagonist is now very, very young, about 8 years old. Okay. Nakusa lives in Baherza Wada. Baherza in Marathi means outer, outside. Okay. The child has never cycled off alone this far from home before. She reaches the outskirts. This town makes no efforts to disguise the way it segregates people. There is no attempt at political correctness. This part of town is called Baherza Wada, the outer neighborhood. Every town has people who, if they want to live, have to stay out of the way of the powerful. People of a lower caste, lesser religion, people who do dirty jobs. This dirt comes from the higher, greater, cleaner, who live in the main town. However, the main town does not want these people to live with them. These people who are supposed to stay out live in the outer neighborhood called the Baherza Wada. The dwellings look poorer as compared to the rest of the town. Children look at her bicycle with envy as she asks them for some directions. I'm going to skip parts and then now she's speaking to Nakusa. I got the money, she whispers proudly. Nakusa laughs and keeps walking. At the foothill, Nakusa climbs onto the bicycle and indicates that the child should sit behind her. Lalita smiles, Lalita is the child, and hops on. They ride away in darkness. Lalita puts her hand around Nakusa's waist. The matted hair, which from a distance looks like something to be feared. You know, you have seen the matted hair, no? The jatta, we call it. Looks like something to be feared, is rough but comforting. And the child lays her cheek on it. Kharkharit, she says, rough. It sounds comforting. It's a rough word, but it sounds comforting. It's that when we don't know a thing enough, when we look at it from a distance, we fear it. But when we actually touch it, so to speak, either emotionally or intellectually, we realize that it is a place of comfort. Okay. Then now I'll again skip some part. And now they've reached her house and they're meeting a small child, Nakusa's daughter. As Nakusa is handing the bicycle back to Lalita, a little girl runs out, holds the edge of her mother's sari and stands shyly behind her. Nakusa pulls her and says she should greet Akka. Lalita Akka is the girl from the big house, so grimy thin hands are folded in a shy, awestruck namaste. Lalita, who is only a few years older to this child, does not know how to react to the namaste and puts out a small town convent school hand which is not shaken. Nakusa wraps both the girls in a warm, sweaty hug. If Jana gets books and Lalita a bit of magic. Now, right to the end of the book when we see Jana again. We see her, but now this is the part. So it's giving her agency and giving. So she's not just a guest appearance, as is, you know, in all our upper caste stories. Lalita and her daughter are waiting. Now this is about 30 years later. Lalita and daughter are waiting. They watch Nakusa riding pillion on Jana's scooter. Jana is now in her late 20s. She's an MD. Both are happy that you're trusting them with the hospital. We had thought maybe you'd come and stay. Jana looks at Lalita. Lalita says to Nakusa, so Nakusa bhai, Jana did get her books then.
Can I ask Meena to respond to this? To respond to, because Nadi started out being very provocative, saying that instead of not dealing with the issue of caste at all, it should be possible to incorporate this into our writings. When she meant our, I think she meant upper caste writers, mainstream upper caste writers. Yes? I would like Meena specifically to respond to that. Also in the context of there is a lot of opposition from Dalits, Dalit intellectuals to upper caste writing about Dalits also. If you can respond to that, we'd be glad to hear it.
Um, I quite don't know how to formulate myself. I think that first it's a gross misstatement to say that Dalits are opposing when upper caste write about caste. It's just not the case. They're possibly picking issues where there's misrepresentation or where there's patronization or where there is stereotyping. So I don't think that per se, you know, it's like Dalits are saying upper caste should not write about caste. On the other hand, I also know that in recent episodes like Arundhati Roy's own introduction to Annihilation of Caste, the issue just became, what do you call, blown extremely out of proportions, and it started taking on a very personal attack on Arundhati Roy. So if you ask me, what do you feel about this? And the fact is, I myself have been called out by, and there is a whole general, and this is not a small thing. I mean, like, I'm young, but I'm not young enough to not know things. I mean, I started when I was 17 translating the books of the leader of the Vidudhalai Sirutaigal or the Dalit Panthers, and now it's like 12, 13 years later, I'm still writing. So what I believe is that there is a general, we have to understand everything politically. So if you look at this politically, the insistence on a certain kind of identity politics, especially an identity politics that also subscribes to capitalism, an identity politics that doesn't you know, want a larger left involvement, or an identity politics that somehow rejects communism, is perhaps at the heart of it, at the heart of you know, this kind of criticisms. Because when I started out, there was not much issue of what my caste was, because on one side my mother is a Shudra, my father belongs to a nomadic tribe. But 10 years ago, 12 years ago, nobody would bother asking. They would know you're intercaste, you're outcaste, you know, out of caste in that sense, like you are. And my father's father were also intermarried, so I come from an extremely intercaste marriage family. We have specifically a nomadic tribe, and then again a nomadic tribe because of the way the Indian state functions. You know, in some states it's Dalit, in some states it's Adivasi, in some states it's even the Narikuravars or the Gypsy people in some states are, you know, called backward caste. How does a tribe become a caste? Because it is so arbitrary. So what I'm so, and people have said that, yeah, Meena claims to be a Dalit, she's not a Dalit. So it has come to me, myself. So, and what do you do when, you know, you face criticism about, are you passing off for a Dalit? And what exactly is a Dalit? So if the word Dalit refers very specifically to scheduled caste, then you're like, okay, because this state system, this Indian government decides arbitrarily who is a scheduled caste, who is not a scheduled caste. So in that case, you say, no, I'm not an SC. But what exactly is it about Dalit? Is the word a larger word than just SC? Is it a word that includes other marginalized groups? Because, for instance, that's the other thing about identity politics, is that you only can speak for yourself. I cannot talk for others, because then it becomes an issue of appropriation. So speaking again for myself, I come from this nomadic tribe, which even from, if you look at Edgar Thurston, he talks about how this tribe survives as witch doctors, and also how they survive by traditional beggary, you know, like being beggars. And even today, if you go to Kerala, and if there are any Malayalis here, they will know that Pandaram is an extremely abusive word. You shout at people, call them Pandaram, which means beggar. So it's an extreme slur word which is used on the day-to-day. But today, if people are looking at you and telling, oh, Meena is not a Dalit, because Meena's caste is not in the SC list, I'm like, fine. I mean, that's again, you know, how do you deal with it? Because on the one hand, you cannot claim the space of untouchability there, because per se, was a tribe untouchable? No, because a tribe was outside of the caste system. And it's also a nomadic tribe, so they never settled anywhere. On the other hand, how could I ever claim to be Dalit in terms of lived experience? Because I grew up in a very privileged background. My parents were highly educated people. I grew up on a university campus. So does Dalit mean somebody who is located outside the caste system, somebody who is a product of intercaste marriages, somebody who is fighting against the caste system, fighting for or identifying with the annihilation of caste? Or does Dalit have to mean very specifically NSC? So these are questions that, you know, keep coming up. And then when people start criticizing, and when they tell, okay, Meena is not a Dalit and she's claiming to be a Dalit, I mean, this was not an issue 12 years ago, that's what I'm trying to say, then you just say, okay, if people are uncomfortable, fine, I don't have to, you know, I can only tell you very honestly what I am and where I am from. So I think it's hugely being problematized. But at the end of the day, the only question is that I believe in communism. I believe that all the working class people have to fight. At some point, we have to know that even if you are like, you know, poor or whatever, unless we bring this class perspective into fighting caste, we just cannot, you know, end this system. Because right now, there's this whole trend of how capitalism is going to be the new savior, how it's erasing identities. I don't think that is happening. What capitalism is doing is making it stark, making it sharp. And the thing is that what kind of a resistance do we want? Do we still want to, you know, just be part of, you know, what the state allows? Or are we going to call out the state for what it does? The kind of structural genocide that the state perpetrates on its Adivasi populations, the kind of patriarchal discourse that the state upholds. So are we just going to be happy to get what the state has guaranteed for us in terms of, let's say, reservation or other things? Or does the Dalit and the anti-caste movement expand beyond that and start to attack the state structure, start to attack global capitalism, identify all enemies? Does attack misogyny? Does it show itself as a feminist front? So for me, I think it's a larger issue. But what I think we have to do is to, you know, approach this with a lot of humility and a lot of honesty, because nothing can be dismissed, you know.
In this context, I don't know if it'd be relevant also, because Meena raised the question of identity politics being in a larger structure of capitalism. How do you think the package of gender also being subsumed under capitalism? How do you react to that? I don't know if this is way off the issue, but since you raised the question of that, I'd also want to know what your reaction would be to gender being subsumed under this category.
Would you like under the category
of the larger structure of capitalism?
Just to start, Nadi. Yes. I think with gender, for instance, Tata, which was at the same time playing, and we are aware, which is wonderfully sponsoring also Meena Kandasamy to sit here and talk about it, which is again the hypocrisy or the sad, tragic state of affairs. Tata, for instance, was running this whole Jagore campaign and also about the power of the 49% when the Indian election was going on. So you have capitalism, which tries to give you this, oh, you are women, go out and vote, show your power, change the state kind of thing. At the same time, same Tata was paying slave labor rates, less than minimum wage, to people working in its plantations, in its tea plantations in Assam. So how, on the one hand, you know, CSR or whatever you call it, and the kind of corporate media incest that goes on, allows Tata to show itself this super progressive image of, you know, oh, we are worried about Indian women, want them to go out and vote. On the other hand, paying them less than minimum wage. And this is not just one corporation that you're talking about. We're talking about Vedanta, which, for instance, talks about, you know, putting, you know, giving medical care. But what does it do to the lives of Adivasi women? You're talking about Isar, which, for instance, takes so much pride that we gave sweaters to 250 tribal children. Come on, but what are you doing to their lives in terms of, you know, your whole mining projects? So there's this huge, huge hypocrisy about capitalism, which claims, and especially because feminism becomes marketable, the, you know, strong women becomes marketable, the sexy woman becomes marketable. And they try to, you know, just ride the wave of feminism to sell their products, and, you know, they're plugging products everywhere. So, and even I think the feminism's biggest crisis is how are you, and you read books even by big writers like Caitlin Moore and How to Be a Woman, everything makes sense. In the last chapter, she says, well, the market gives you choice. I'm like, what choice does the market give you? So the thing is that, yeah, somehow the celebration of feminism itself sometimes becomes a celebration of the market, which is hugely problematic, because are we criticizing the market enough? Are we criticizing capitalism enough? And yeah, it's also not, I'm not going to be depressive, because today Syriza won the elections in Greece. So yeah, there is going to be a resurgence of left. There is going to be a resurgence of, you know, alternative politics that tells you that capitalism is not the answer.
I'm not going to say anything about feminism, which Meena has covered, but about what ma'am said about how caste and gender and capitalism. Okay, now a woman who is of a lower caste, she has this kind of intersectional identity. She's oppressed because she's a woman and because she's a Dalit woman. So it's a double oppression. So, and because she mentioned capitalism is changing the nature of work in our country. Okay, work is no longer, first of all, the government is pulling out of everything. So it's no longer socialism. So we are not going to end garibi hatao chala gaya abhi. Now there is no going to be alleviation of property, but we are going to help somebody, the poor, manage property. And who are good managers? What is the image of the woman? The nurturing good manager. So the woman will now manage property also. Work conditions have changed so that there are no workplaces, there are no factories, but small gallas. Okay, there is work from home, where a woman doesn't have insurance benefits, doesn't have fixed hours, so she doesn't go out to work, but she gets work on a job basis at very small piece rates. You will be shocked. I mean, the middle class people will be shocked when they hear about the rates, at the piece rates at which women do this work, like small, you know, putting buttons on sweaters, and they do it at home. So then again, the double burden that we talk about, that she's not relieved of her domestic work, she's working there. So home is no longer a place of leisure. It never was. Home was never a place of leisure for the woman. It was a place of work. But she's doing that at the same time. She's working and she's doing. Yet, she's not the primary worker. Because who is going out to work? The man is going out to work. She's the secondary worker. So her status at home financially has remained the same. Her status about her backache has remained the same, because she's picking up the child and doing the work. And she has no insurance. Okay. Now, that's the problem with how the capitalism has affected women. So that's gender. And now caste. So now the Dalit woman. We know how her body is always, as Ambedkar said, the stigma of the dirty work that they do. The stigma is carried on the body of the woman, the dirty work. We made them do, the upper caste people made us do the dirty work. And now they see that dirt on my body. So my body is stigmatized. Okay. At one end, you say that we are ending scavenging. And we all clap. Okay, that the scavenging is going to be ended. On the other hand, who is being pulled into prostitution? Which caste woman is working in the massage parlor? Which caste woman is doing care services? Because women in the family are moving out to work, so who is getting care professions? Care means looking after the personal this of anybody who is not kin. So this work usually gets relegated to the lower caste woman. That's what she asked about the caste and the woman come in capitalism.
Thank you so much. I'd like to ask Meena something about her book, and then, you know, maybe we can have some time for audience interaction. This is Meena's latest book. I don't know how many of you have seen that. I'd like to ask her specifically to speak a little bit about the intersection of caste and gender in this book. Mm-hmm. And I have a specific question. I'm lumping it all together. Why hasn't this book been reviewed in India? I'm a little curious, because I've read the book, but I've read reviews from abroad. I haven't read reviews from India. So I also like to ask her about the reaction, Indian responses to this book.
Like Nadi, I also selected some passages, because the whole idea is that increasingly, just to say very briefly, you know, I started out with, you know, working with Dalit political parties, and then there was an increasing identification with the left and what the left can achieve. I mean, not Indian Marxist Party anyway, CPM, I'm making it very clear, but what the left generally means. And because when you start to read, for instance, about the working class in Madras, for instance, and about the kind of trade union activity that you have, for the Madras Labour Party is one of the oldest communist organizations in India. It was started the year after the Russian Revolution. So you had this series of strikes, you have this extreme working class militancy, you have fights on the shop floor, and it's brilliant. And then you see all these instances which somehow get into history of how Dalit people are recruited by the management, like say the Bini company, to become the strike breakers, to become what you call traditionally the scab or the black leg. And then that's very depressing, and we clearly can see that, you know, the caste stigma as well as extreme poverty and the fact that, you know, they have no other support would have allowed them to play this role, you know, of being, you know, put into a situation of becoming strike bearers, because this is a community for which all reasons is very militant, is for all reasons standing up against oppression. So in order to, you know, like see that this kind of narrative which does exist in, let's say, academia, I was trying to look at an instance where Dalit militancy, especially Dalit reference of, you know, to communism and the way that they carried forward the communist struggle was super important and vital. And so that's the reason why I got to write about Keel Venmani, because this is a place where 44 Dalit men, women and children were massacred or burnt alive to death because they were asking for a wage increase or half an extra measure of rice. But also, if you look quite closely or deeply at the background, this entire village was all Dalit, and they were standing up against untouchability and feudalism both. So for me, that was that was an important part to write about, the Dalits' place within the communist movement and how they were standing up for, you know, the rights of all workers, and how they laid their lives, they became martyrs for the rights of all workers, especially all landless agricultural laborers of the Tanjore district. And even today, if you come to my part of the world of Tanjore, nobody can speak anything about working class or rights or a communism or anything without reference to Keelvanmani. So that is the important thing. If there is time, I will read, but otherwise I can just keep the reading. Having said that, what was the other question?
Intersection of caste and gender in your book.
In my book, well, there's a lot of intersection of caste and gender. I'm not an academic, so I cannot, you know, actually talk about it. It's for other people to see how it it does intersect, or does it intersect at all. But maybe I can read some kind of... would you like to hear me read? No? Yes? Okay, so the book keeps starting with the story of an old woman that I'm trying to say. She's, and so I'll just read some sections. I have been dabbling in the art of abandoning too. Once being impressed with the French anarchist writer Felix Finian and his novel, in three lines, I attempted to adapt his brilliant fragmented form to continue to tell my version of the story of the old woman in a tiny village. Over the course of considerable time, I was able to write a few tiny excerpts of her history, but I gave up, unable to sustain my momentum. The entire story that I was waiting to tell seemed to lie outside of her. Did she have it in her to hold a village together? Could I show everything in these snippets? Riddled with self-doubt, I stopped trying to make my story fit into this form. It was an interesting experiment while it lasted. Weeks later, I felt my jottings were not good enough to get into the book because the characters had not got into them. Once I realized that becoming a mistress of the compress and express form of storytelling was not for me, I played with the idea of moving on. Out of habit, I lingered, toying with these time release capsules. So now these are the excerpts. One Karupai of Tiruchuli village in the Ramnad district recounts that during the Great Famine, she lost her husband and her three little sons. She managed to stay alive, eating handfuls of mud. Taking pity on her because of her pregnant condition, a relief worker fed her kanji every day. The second story, in December 1877, the Gunda River in Ramnad swelled suddenly, breaking her banks in her haste to meet the sea. Karupai went to Trankebar, finding shelter at the home of the relief worker who saved her life. Many others were not as lucky. They survived the famine, but not the floods. The Royal Gazetteer recorded over 1,000 deaths in the first week. Chinnamma of Irukkai, the third story, of Irukkai died on 15th August 1925 from complications arising out of childbirth. The death due to septic shock resulted from the use of an agricultural sickle to cut her umbilical cord. The newborn was handed over to her grandmother, Karupai, a domestic help of Europeans in Trankebar. Story 4. Trankebar is reeling from the shock of witnessing the 60th rape of the last 3 weeks. Dragged from her grandmother's home at the outskirts of the town, the 14-year-old girl heard nothing but her own screams through the night. The landlord rapist did not stop, nor did they dignify her with a single word. Sources in Nagapattinam confirmed that no case was filed. Preliminary reports indicate the rape took place on the night of 16 December 1939. The gang rape's victim's name has been withheld for reasons of anonymity. She will be referred to as she in all reports, including in the regular feel-good stories that we are committed to publishing. Story number 5. She went to Sanna see a Vandrik witch doctor, the strongest man she saw. Sannasi's priest would end her when she offered him the wondrous pleasure of her breasts. Before the next summer, they were married and she had given birth to his son. The next story. When the exiled Tayyan, the witch doctor's brother, was found to have crept back to Keelvanmani to steal a look at his one-year-old nephew, he was beaten to death, doused in kerosene and set alight. For concealing information about their brother's visit, Sannasi and Periyan were whipped mercilessly. Police declared Tayyan's death an arson-related accident on the landlord Purayar's farm. On 14 April 1965, untouchables around Kivalur dismantled a temple chariot in protest at not being granted the right to pull it through the streets. Caste Hindus retaliated by burning the defiled chariot. Sannasi, suspected mastermind of this protest, was abducted the next day and his body turned up 2 weeks later in Karaikal. Police have closed the case as a mysterious death. The last of the stories. To avenge her husband's death, Sannasi's widow stepped out onto the Communist Party circuit. Asked to describe her, a comrade in Keelvanmani said, she knows what to say, when, how to say what, when to start a why, where to seize the talk. similarly pressed, a landlord said, "Oh, the old women, that troublemaking communist cunt, that untouchable whore, get out of here." This time I moved on. So what I'm trying to show from these excerpts is the story of this one old woman, which runs, you know, through the story. So about it's, and I think it's an intersection not just of caste and gender, but also about what did this mean to be landless and working as a, you know, bonded slave of sorts to landlords, and what does it mean, you know, when you're a victim of all kinds of violence, especially rapes, which Tamil women cutting across caste boundaries have huge, huge shame and taboo in talking about. So that is how I think this story, I mean, there is no central character. The central character of the book is the village of Keel Venmani, which I like to think as a women, but there is also this one strong woman who does hold the village together. And so she's called Mai for the purposes of the story. But yeah, so there are a lot of very powerful women here. And why does the book not get reviewed? I just don't know. And honestly, at some point, I just don't care, because I think what really matters is that you know you write. And because I think if you're a poet, you really get very thick skin. I mean, like, you read to audiences of 4 people, 5 people, nobody bothers. So if when you're a novelist, you're like, you don't get reviews, you're happy. You get invited to festivals, you're happy. You don't get invited, you're happy. In the sense that I think what bothers me more is what I'm going to write next and what I'm reading and how I spend my time.
I'm a little curious, as I think some of you will be. Does Nadi feel the same way about reviewers and audience and listeners? Because I think women are less thick-skinned than men. We look far more for approval and love than men do. So do you feel the same way as Meena does?
No, my book, I'm not ashamed to say, does not have any international reviews at all. I'm at the other end of the spectrum. Some very small spaces on websites, and some newspapers like Outlook, and you know, some good publications, and then local papers in Pune. And but local people have, Indian people have reviewed. I don't know whether, I should ask my publisher, I'd say, oh, has he gone to some other session? But I don't know whether it has reached abroad or not. I've got letters from people in, women in Indonesia, and who have, not Indians who are living there, but people who are from there, who have read the book and liked it. And then letters from Pakistan and Bangladesh, such countries. Yeah, but personal letters, no reviews, no international reviews. And my book is very simple and very accessible language. So it's like I was telling ma'am before the session, it's like a Maharashtrian speaking English, you know. It's like a Marathi medium Maharashtrian girl speaking English. So it's not really, it's a very accessible book. And housewives are reading it, and, you know, I've read it. And I was also telling ma'am that a friend of mine, a comrade friend of mine, she said that it is about caste, it is about gender, it is about the religious, you know, Hindu-Muslim divide and all. So some women like that have also read it, but mainly it is very, just women like me. And no international review at all.
Now that we have just 10 minutes, you know, and we could stretch it to 15, can we have, yes, after Nadi speaks, can we open the thing for the audience?
I have noticed this time that the moderators in all the sessions were, you know, professors and academically inclined people who knew about this. So I would like her to take 5 minutes and tell us what she thinks about, you know, caste and gender in, yeah, I want you to, no, I think we should, yeah. Yes.
Why are you catching me? I mean, I came with such great difficulty to this forum. Because I'm not a speaker, and, you know, I'm sort of, what do you say, bull in a china shop.
Because so, we tend to sell our books, you know, this book, this constantly bring the discussion to this. So she doesn't have a book to sell right now, so she will speak.
Well, I did write one book, and that book was the single book which I wrote by myself, because the other books are co-authored, was about manual scavengers. The title was India Stinking. And it was about manual scavengers since I publish books, so, you know, I don't ever speak about the books I write. It's not done. It's like, it's not done to speak about the work one has done. But I was amazed much after the book was published that some people, which is why I asked Meena, some people said, why did she have to write about us? You know, I was so shocked to hear that comment.
Luckily, it came much after the book was published. Why did she have to write about us? You know, I was very wounded by that. Because I had written, that was the only book I wrote, and that was a book which came out from, you know, from the pits of my stomach. It came out from my belly. I felt so strongly about that work. And to hear about a comment, why did someone like her, because I'm upper caste, and why did she have to write about us? I mean, if you wanted to write about yourself, you should have, but why are you stopping other people from writing about, you know? It's not about you. We are all part of each other. See, I may have been born upper caste, but I share the experiences I hear, I share, I internalize, I work with people. So all of us are mixed in some way. Of course, I'm not saying I'm taking on your identity, but we are so much. So why are we putting up further walls? I mean, there are walls bad enough in our society. Why are we putting up further walls? This is what I feel about both caste and gender. Gender, of course, you know, at one time, you know, one would say, I'm a woman and you're a man, you wouldn't know what I felt. But over the years, one also feels that, you know, you can't kill all the men in the world. You have got to change people. You can't kill all the upper castes. You've got to change them. So the more walls we break down, the better is what I feel about both caste and gender. I think that's about it. So can we now go on to audience responses, please?
Hello? Yeah.
Can we?
Yeah, I am having... Hello, hello, hello.
Hello, hello. Well, yeah. Meena, your title, Gypsy Goddess, reminds me of God of Small Things. How your Gypsy Goddess is different from other goddesses?
Gypsy Goddess, I think the title is very self-referential and very funny and ironic in many senses in terms of the novel. And it also, because the entire way in which I have told the story trolls the form of the novel and tries to break what the novel is about, so... I'm trying to say that you can have a title that has nothing to do with the book on one hand. On the other hand, Gypsy Goddess is, in Tamil, it's Kurathi Amman, which is also my ancestral goddess. And so I was, you know, trying to have some fun there. But the myth of the Gypsy Goddess is about how the people who are nomads have, because of the travel that's involved, have highly patriarchal myths about women's chastity. And so when women, like there are seven women of this particular tribe who get separated from their husbands and are lost along with their children. And it's just one night, you know, and the next night they come and join the rest of the tribes. But what happens is that these seven women and the children are burnt alive. They're either burnt alive or they're asked to run and then their heads are chopped off. There are many, many versions of this myth. But what later people do is that, you know, there's so many bad things start happening to this tribe. So they make these seven dead women, seven they say, 17 they say, into goddesses. And that is called the Kurathi Amman. That's the myth of the Kurathi Amman. And for me, this is an important myth because in Keelvanmani, if you look at it, the maximum number of people who died or were burnt to death are women and children because only they stayed back in the village. But also it shows this whole idea because the men ran away, the men managed to make themselves safe. They left the women, you know, in a sense, unguarded, unprotected, and the women died, you know, when the landlords came and burned them up. So on one hand, it's a clear thing about what's this whole idea of who is the hero. And what's the role of the male? Who is the male a protector? But also this huge idea of even in the most marginalized and the most resilient militant spaces or most equal, there is this idea of, you know, controlling women and punishment that's given to women and things like that. So yeah, it's and the myth, I think, is slightly, for me, metaphorically, I do connect it to what happened in Keelvanmani, even if they are completely different in their character. The fact that, yeah, today Venmani is a kind of idolized example that we communists and Dalits like look in the background and we feel proud about. And I think it's the same with Gypsy Goddess in that sense that she has become a goddess, like even if she was a martyr, even if she was sacrificed, that, you know, there is a certain ascendancy into the divine.
One question to Meena.
Mm-hmm.
Can we talk about feminism and Dalitism, Dalit issues without referring or without dragging into communism? That is a question I want to ask you. Because I felt some confusion, like you were talking about feminism and about Dalits, but you were invariably going off into communism. Can you separate these two from communism? That is one I would like to. Nadi, I would like to, like, we have this Dalit literature, Dalit Sahityam, which we call here. Is there a possibility of taking it into the mainstream, which has more advantage, keeping it separate as a Dalit literature or trying to mainstream it into the mainstream literature?
See, the thing is that I'm not dragging anything into communism. I'm just trying to say that there has to be an alternative to capitalism. Yeah. I will talk about it. Okay. Yeah. I will address that. Yeah. See, the thing is, we talk about feminism, but we are also living in a world where we have huge structural inequalities in pay. Women are not paid what men are paid. You know what I try to mean. And then how many women are bosses, and how many? See, the fact is that we certainly have a one person that's dominating all of us. So even as feminists, do we subscribe to the market or do we not subscribe? What does the market do, or what does capitalism do to our bodies? And so I think as a feminist, we start challenging capitalism at some point because it is oppressive.
Can we have her?
No. That's, as a feminist, how can you not criticize capitalism? Because capitalism is doing... Look, you go into Bangalore and you have these advertisements for 18 again, and you have advertisements for vaginal skin lightening creams. As a feminist, are you not ashamed like that somebody is trying to sell something like this? That somebody is trying to, you know, plug products like this? As a feminist, are we not ashamed that the skin lightening industry is $1 billion of money that's just being, you know, to make us feel bad about ourselves, about our skin colors? I mean, as feminists, we have to be super ashamed of what capitalism is doing. So I think that as a feminist, how can you not react? Like, thin women are seen as beautiful. If you are adding fat, everybody's like, you know, that's not even marketed. There is a certain, you know, if you're short, it's not marketed. I mean, like, aren't some of us become anorexic because of what capitalism is trying to push on to us? I mean, it's like, it's fucking with our bodies. I mean, why wouldn't we start attacking capitalism for what it is? Part A. And then again, as Dalits, I mean, I have worked with Dalit parties. I've seen, you can not win any election in the Indian democracy without the support and without one muscle power, and second, without money power. And where does the money come from? Today we know that corporates are the biggest sponsors of all elections, whether it's the BJP or whether it's the Congress. So do we want a government that, it doesn't matter whether it's BJP or Congress, you can keep kicking them out? Isn't Tata running the show of the country? Isn't Vedanta running the show of the country? Who is calling the shots in this country? Isn't it the big corporations who are dealing? Look at the amount of, you know, like, huge land, and who is, you know, like, appropriating it? What does Reliance do? Isn't Adani dictating what happens in India? And so as Indians, why wouldn't we get upset about it? I mean, and as people who want to challenge the caste structure, so we have to also challenge capitalism, because we see it very firsthand. And the thing is that we just cannot say, okay, capitalists are giving me some money and they're giving Congress some money. That is just not how it is done. And also, I think I'm a communist not because I also have issues, but I believe that in the working class militancy, I believe that the working class can cause change. And I'm going to, you know, keep driving this and dragging this everywhere. And also, I want to tie it up with Geeta Ramaswamy's point, is that in early communists, the people who are organizing, the people of Keelvanmani, for instance, or the people in the Tanjore district, like, there is a comrade called B. Srinivas Rao, who is not even Tamil, he spoke Telugu. He was, like, obviously from Rao, he was a Brahmin. But when he is a communist, when he decides to let go of his caste privilege, when he lets go of his caste identity, goes in the village, works with the people, you know, is militant, is trying to organize them, is trying to, you know, he was underground, you know, trying to face the extreme amount of police repression, can you say that, okay, this man is now an upper caste? No, you cannot. I think in a sense, communism loves you to step out of narrow identity politics, and we need that. Anuradha Gandhi, she's another person who gave up her privilege. So, and I mean, I'm sorry for, you know, bringing up these examples, but unless the whole left wakes up to the issue, the crucial issue of caste, and unless the rest of the caste movements wake up to the importance of communism and the importance of, you know, Marxism and challenging capitalism, we just cannot annihilate the caste system as it exists today. Thank you.
Thank you. If the answer could be short, yes, because very, very, the other speakers
short.
Are
I'll
waiting.
I'll speak with you afterwards also. What's your name? Satyavati. I'll just add, I agree with her, but communists have an idea that if everybody became workers, then women and men would be equal, male workers, women workers. Okay, but then the Dalit woman is asking, but I have been a worker for so many centuries, and that has not solved any of my problems. So, therefore, Dalit feminism, is to put it very simply. And about the mainstream literature, in a better world, the Dalit literature would be mainstream, I feel. But we'll talk later.
Yeah. It was.
Thank you so much, all of you. The next, the next
It was amazing to see the kind of passion that this has. Ladies, we are very impressed. Thank you so very much indeed for raising such important critical issues.